Very good evening to all of you present over here. Myself Utkarsh, the moderator of today's webinar, welcome you all on behalf of my trusted tutor family. Let me introduce my trusted tutor first. MyTrustedTutor.com is a marketplace for private tutors, schools, teachers, academicians, all kinds of educational professions who can help with the school assignment. Our mission or main motive is to make quality education available with ease and affordable to all. Our today's webinar speaker is Mrs. Uzma Charalia, who is going to provide a lecture on burnout and time management. Now let me introduce ma'am. She has completed MCOM CA. She has 9 years of teaching experience. She runs her own educational institute in Mumbai for CA, CMA, CIMA UK students and commerce subjects to IGCSE and IB students. Now it's over to you ma'am. You can go.
Thank you so much, Utkarsh, for the wonderful introduction. Only thing, not Mrs. Miss, not yet married. But that's okay. Not an issue. All right. Good evening, all the attendees. It is very nice to have you all. Thank you so much for your time this Sunday evening. So, topic that I would like to touch today is about burnout and time management. The topic that I want to talk about today is burnout and time management. Let us see what we get to learn, what all of us can learn from this. Before I begin, let us understand what is burnout. When you talk about burnout, some people say that it is being stressed, it is being not able to concentrate on certain things. So technically, burnout is way beyond stress. For stress is normal. When you talk about burnout, it is way beyond stress. It is a state of emotional exhaustion, physically exhausted, and you're mentally exhausted. Stress never goes out. There are days when you're only physically tired, you sleep, the next day you're fine. There are days when you're very angry, you take your some time out, you're okay. Some days you feel like crying, some days you want to be left alone, but the other day you're okay. And these all things pile up long for a longer time. That is known as burnout. So it is a very dangerous state. It is way beyond your stress level. Before we actually delve into burnout, how do you understand it's a burnout? There are 5 stages for us to better understand whether what we are suffering through is stress or whether somebody who's around us is suffering from stress or maybe from burnout. That are 5 stages. Let us look at one by one what the 5 stages are. Stage 1, known as the honeymoon phase. All know honeymoon, it's a very good word when you newly married and the first thing that you do is your honeymoon phase. So similarly, stage 1 of your burnout is honeymoon phase. What happens is when you undertake a new task, when there's something new, some new challenge come up, some new work commitment come up, what you do when or you're promoted or you're given a new job, you're very excited. Very excited to start something new. You'll have a rush of excitement, you'll be very happy, you'll be very optimistic towards it, you will take little steps towards the job, you will try and make a good impression, you will be very proactive in this job. What are the symptoms? When you were in the honeymoon phase, what exactly are the symptoms? See, you have job satisfaction because this is really new. What you have, you begin with job satisfaction because we humans, we have this problem of boredom. So when there's something new that comes into our life, something new that you start doing, the first thing that we experience is job satisfaction. The second thing is you will readily accept responsibilities. If you think or you put yourself as someone who's taken up a new job, got into a new relationship, got into new friendship, what you do? Be very proactive. You readily start taking responsibilities on yourself. You have very high energy levels. Why? Because this is something new and something very challenging which we've taken up. So initially you're very energetic in this stage, your honeymoon phase. Next is unbridled optimism. You are very optimistic. You want to prove your worth. You want to do well. You want to do well for yourself, for your organization, for the people around you. You are very committed to the job at hand. When you start something new, you do it with more than 100% of your effort. You are completely committed to the job at hand. The next is, there is a compulsion. Even though you don't want to prove yourself, there will always be a compulsion to prove yourself. When you start a new job, when you take something new, obviously everybody wants to prove himself that he is good for the job. He is the best candidate that the company could have selected. He is the best teacher that the school could have had. So you have a compulsion on your head. There's ongoing compulsion on your head that you have to prove yourself. Next is just free-flowing creativity, because you start something new, there are new ideas that come up, you meet new people, there are new things that you get to learn. So there's a lot of free flow of creativity at this stage. Next is there is high productive level. At the earlier job, you are the same person. Earlier when you used to do some job, you were not that productive. Suddenly when there's a change of your job, a change of a work scenario, change of responsibility, initially your productivity levels are very high. Next comes stage two. All keep enjoying the stage one, but want it or not, you go into stage two, and this is emotionally, physically, mentally, you get into stage two. Let us see what is stage two. This is the onset of stress. So you've started, you finish your honeymoon phase, and now the second stage that is coming in is the onset of stress. What happens here? This is when your actual burnout begins. You can say this is the birth of your burnout. This is when you will be feeling tired. There are days you will be taking off from work. You're, at this point of time, you may have enemies also. Your new job, you must have found your friends. You must have found your enemies also. There will be deadlines. You will not be liking it. There will be some part of the job. You may be enjoying your whole scenario, but there are some parts of the job that you didn't like continuing or you don't like doing. This is when the birth of burnout happens. So this stage is known as the awareness stage. More aware we become at this stage, the more prolonged stress we can avoid. What are the common symptoms of this stage? High blood pressure. Start experiencing high blood pressure. It's inability to focus. There's too much on your plate. There's too much in your hand. You're not able to focus on one particular job and get it done. Next is irritability. You are always irritated. If not even always, there are certain trigger points. If somebody comes and tell you, you take it the wrong way and you're mostly irritable. Irritable at work, irritable at home. This is job dissatisfaction. This is when it starts. You don't like doing it, because it is also human nature. You can't avoid, no matter how much you convince yourself, no, you have to do the job, you like it. At some point of time, you stop liking this. You stop liking a particular task, or you start hating one of your boss, start hating one of your colleague, you start hating one of your supervisor, something or the other will come. It's just there's lack of sleep, reduced sleep. Because this is the onset of stress, you may not realize, but maybe sleeping a little less, but there'll be reduced sleep quality. One second, excuse me. Utkarsh, I think there are people coming in. Please let them in. Sorry, attendees. Lack of social interaction. You get so busy. We come around people. They start a new job. Very happy. After some point of time, you can't see them anywhere. Too busy. The only thing that they say, I'm busy. I'm busy. I'm busy. So, the lack of social interaction. It happens with us also that we pick up a new job, we dive into it, we dive too deep, and then what happens? You're busy. No time for school, no time for home, no time for friends, no time for movies, no time for outings. You lack social interaction. Next is your productivity lowers, because what you're doing is you're pushing yourself. You don't want to do it. You're not liking it. You're not giving your 100%. What is happening? Your productivity will fall down. Next is anxiety. Anxiety will come in. Now, when I say anxiety, there are people coming to me and they say that anxiety is a disease. It is a disease at a very later stage. The very little anxiety that comes in, that what am I going to do? What is tomorrow going to bring? What if my boss tells me this? What is the minute what strikes in? This is your first stage of anxiety. So it may not be a high level anxiety that causes depression. Low levels of anxiety also come in here at the second stage. The third is avoidance of decision making. You work, you are given responsibility, you don't like taking decisions. Why? Because you are starting to get negative. You are starting to get pessimistic. You don't like, because why? You know there will be somebody, because you've had, now at this stage you have your own enmity, you have your hate towards somebody. That somebody also has the same feeling, you know, and he may spoil your job. So you avoid taking decisions. You avoid being too active what you were in stage one. The change in appetite or diet. There are people who eat too much. Some people, diet goes. They're not able to eat. Even if they're feeling hungry, they see food, feel like khana. They start skipping meals. Or there are people who are the opposite. They tend to overeat. The only thing that you see them doing is eating a lot of sweet. And there's fatigue. You are consistently tired. Always, whenever somebody see you, like, this person is very tired, you will find yourself consistently tired. This is your stage two. You tend to get forgetful. when you have a lot to do, what happens is the deadline is gone, then you suddenly remember, oh, I had to do this. It happens with all of us. Forgetfulness is one sign of stress. If you know what you had to do, but you miss the deadline, you somehow forget and you don't understand, how did I forget such a thing? Not a forgetful person, but this forgetfulness tends to come into the system. This is when you get to know this is your stage two of stress. And then you have general neglect of your personal needs. What we usually do, we don't take hair fall ho raha hai, hone do. Hote ho raha hai, hone do. You know you have to exercise, you don't want to exercise. You know you have to wake up early, you don't want to wake up early. You know drinking too much of tea is not good for you, you still keep drinking. You know you have to drink water at certain interval, you say, jaane do. You have this attitude of neglecting your own personal needs. The next is grinding your teeth at night. You may not realize this because when you yourself are stressed, could do this when you're asleep. The people around you, the people who sleep with you, the people who are next to you will come to know you will start grinding your teeth at night. Next is headaches. You will have headaches. Something or the other, work comes in, there's something extra that you have to do. The only thing that happens to you is, I have a headache. Even little small tasks which were very easier, you used to do it without any trouble, now they give you a headache. Next is heart palpitation. This is a very higher stage when your anxiety is gone double, and that is when you have a very, I say heart palpitation, I'm talking about rhythmic movement of your heart. Sometimes it's beating very fast, sometimes it's beating very slow, you have sweaty palms, you're sweating too much. That is when it comes in, your stage two. Next is stage three, known as chronic stress. So the symptoms of stress, if this continue, what happens, you get chronic stress. This is the third stage of burnout, known as chronic stress. Your stress at this level, you are only facing motivation, you've become completely negative. This is, you can say, third degree torture when kisi ko hum bolte. So this is the third degree level of your stress. You are the third stage of chronic stress. You say third degree torture, something which has gone way beyond your control. At stage two, you realize you could have control, but now you've crossed stage two, and at stage three, at this stage, you are unable to get yourself out. That is when you say it is chronic stress. Let us look at the symptoms of chronic stress. First is lack of hobbies. There were things you used to like, there were things you used to do on a daily basis, you've stopped doing it. You just don't want to do anything. Next is you start missing work deadlines. You know you have to do certain thing, you don't do it. You know this is your target, you don't achieve it. And this you do it purposefully, that I don't want to do. This is what happens. You purposefully miss your work deadlines and targets. Next is persistent tiredness in the morning. The earlier stage we saw fatigue. Fatigue is end of the day. Once you're done, you're too tired. Now chronic stress has come in. You will feel very tired in the morning. You don't feel like waking up. And even if you wake up to wake up with the feeling that even though how much you've slept, this tiredness doesn't go. It's always there. You're always continuously feeling tired. It's just physical illness. We know stress is the root cause of illness. Here you will start having some medical issues or the other. Next is procrastination at work, at home. You not want to do the job. You will say, I'll do it tomorrow. And that tomorrow never comes. And now this has also started affecting your personal life at home also. There will be a lot of tasks that you will stop doing. You will say, I just don't want to do this. Next is repeated lateness for work. Because you don't like doing work, you are purposefully missing deadlines, you will either out from work or you will repeatedly be late for work every day. Half an hour late, 15 minutes late, an hour late, absenteeism will increase from work. The next is resentfulness. You are just unhappy. No matter what happens, you are just resented, you are just unhappy. Nothing makes you happy at this stage. Next is social withdrawal from friends and family. You don't like meeting friends. Even if you have friends, you don't often talk to them. You become quiet. You get inside your own shell and then you don't like talking. You're quiet at home. With friends, you even if you're interacting, you're not speaking what is troubling you, you are just withdrawing yourself out. Next is uptick of escape activities. When you say escape activities, is you know, we have people who end moment they say that something urgent has come up and they don't turn up for social gatherings. There are people who say, they suddenly got an urgent work, something or the other happened, and they never turn up. They do this on a very regular basis. This is not escape activities because they're too resented. They don't know what to do. They are so stressed out that they don't like meeting people. So they initially they accept the invitation and the end moment they escape from the situation, saying that something or the other has come up and they don't end that situation. This is anger or aggressive behavior. They get very angry. Even there were issues where you no reaction was necessary, but they end up going off their mind. They end up saying things which they later repent. They have a very aggressive behavior towards others. This is apathy. Apathy is, they are feeling bad. And when I say apathy, you're feeling bad for your own self. They know what they're doing is wrong. They want to come out of it, and then they're not able to come out of it. The stress levels are such high that even if they try to do things, their emotions, their mental, their mind is not allowing them to do certain things. They're feeling bad for themselves. Then there's chronic exhaustion. Whatever, even little tasks will make them really tired. Even sitting at one place also, they'll get tired. They will have no motivation. Is they'll have a very cynical attitude. Like I said, they'll become very negative. Not only negative towards their work, they'll start getting negative towards the family, towards... they start thinking that, you come across people who are so chronically exhausted, so cynical, that they are not able to see the silver lining. They just don't want to work. They just feel that it is not important. It is not going to fetch them any benefit. The next is denial of problems at work at home. And this stage, what happens is people around you will start realizing that something or the other is going wrong. You are behaving in such a manner, there will be people around you who will come to you. And what you will do is you will start denying your problems. You will say, kuch nahi hua, all is okay. You just say, I want to be left alone. There's nothing. Mera mood nahi hai. Aise bolke, you will start avoiding people. You just don't want to face them. You don't want to face your problem. Next is you feel threatened or panic. Why do you feel threatened or panic? Because you've been missing deadlines. You've not been doing your work. You are repeatedly late. So always there is this threatened feeling. There's this panic that agar mere boss ne pucha main kya karunga, kya bahana dunga, what reason will I give? They ask me, if there are people who come facing me and ask me what is wrong with me, why is this not done, why is that not done, they are perpetually, they're feeling panicked and threatened. This feeling of panic will pressurize them. They will feel that their work is out of control, life has gone out of control. There's no way that they can bring this back. There's no way to help themselves out. So they feel pressurized and they feel out of control. Then there's increased alcohol or drug consumption. If not, also increased caffeine consumption. When I say caffeine consumption over here, there's increased intake of tea. Like most of us are teachers over here, usually come across teachers the whole day after. After one lecture's over, which we all know it's a bad habit, but it is also one of your symptoms that you are stressed and you are trying to relieve yourself, giving yourself a breather with that increased consumption of tea, coffee, or in worse situations, people go to drug abuse or alcoholic abuse. These are the stages. Next stage, the stage 4, is burnout. Now it is, you are entering the fourth stage, and this is more usually this stage you need clinical intervention. Not only your friends, family won't be able to help you, you need medical advice. This is the worst situation when you say burnout. So you see, stress is this, burnout is this. If stress is at this level, burnout is at this level. This is how bad the burnout is. So see the symptoms of burnout. Development of escapist mentality. Not only from social gathering, you start running away from your close ones, you start running away from your family, you start feeling empty inside, you don't feel good about yourself. Then you start feeling that unworthiness, that you're not capable to do the job. This feeling strikes in, and you have obsessions over problem or at work and at life. You become too obsessed. You feel that your problem is the biggest problem. If there's somebody who comes and talks his or her heart out to you, what this is, the problem is much bigger. You don't try to empathize with others. You don't listen. You are just obsessed with your own self, your own problem, your own life. You have very pessimistic. When I say pessimistic, you just don't want to do things. When you say just don't want to do things, if you are set to sleep the whole day, these people will sleep the whole day. That level of pessimism has come into their life. Next is... their physical symptoms, whatever physical illness had come in, it will intensify. Your migraines, your headache, your palpitations, your anxiety attacks, your panic attacks, all these will start coming into these stages. Next is you will start doubting yourself. It is when you start feeling empty inside, even when you know you're good at something, suddenly you just don't know how to do the job. Even if you do, you start making mistakes because you're doubting yourself. The thing you were an expert at, now those things become difficult for you. You're not able to do those little tasks. It's just social isolation. You stay in one corner. You will completely close yourself. Now, at this stage, you need medical advice because you're you are so isolated. You've taken yourself out from so many people that there's no way to reach you, no way to break the wall and communicate to you. Then there are behavioral changes. Suddenly they act mad. Some days you don't know why they are laughing too much. Some days they will actually cry. You just can't predict their behavior. There are people we come across, suddenly they're okay. Suddenly something or the other happens to them and you're like, so those behavioral changes, extreme behavioral changes set in these people. Then chronic headache, your entire headaches, not able to concentrate, not able to, even if you read something, you have a headache, looking at the screen will give you a headache. You will have chronic headaches, which will not even go with medications. And then you will have, these people will have stomach aches, bowel problems, they'll be constipated or continuously visiting the loo over and over again. There will be digestion problems. Then complete neglect of personal needs. When I say personal needs, these people don't even like brushing their teeth, don't even like having a bath, don't even like combing their hair, just sitting at one place, they just don't want to do anything. That is the level of neglect they get into. Next is continuation or increase in escapist activity. What you start with, you keep doing that over and over again. You just want to run away, you just don't want to follow anything, you want to stay away from everybody. This is what happens. Next stage is you desire to drop out of society. There are people that they don't want to live there anymore. They want to move away from friends. They want to. There are people suddenly they say, no, I want to relocate. I want to move cities. I just want to do this. They change jobs very often. They change their residence very often. Nothing makes them happy. So this desire also steps in. The next stage. Even stage 4 is manageable, but there are people who reach stage 5, and the stage 5 is known as habitual burnout. You get into the habit of burnout. 4th was burnout, this is habitual burnout. You are into that stage that it becomes a norm. It's like it's become an emotional problem, not just stress or burnout. These people cannot get out into it. Even therapy won't help these people. That is habitual burnout. Symptoms are chronic sadness. They're always happy. They're always sulking. If you see their face, you feel pity for them. That's how bad the sadness has stepped in. They're depressed. This is the level of depression. So my friends, when people say depression, they link anxiety to depression. No. Depression is habitual burnout. They've been stressed. They've gone into chronic stress. They've gone into burnout and now they're way beyond burnout. That is when depressed. And burnout syndromes. When you say burnout syndromes, they have all sort of illnesses at one go. There is not one medication that they are taking. There are two medications, all of it going into their body and nothing helps. Next is chronic mental fatigue. Now they are mentally tired. First they were only physically tired. Now they are mentally so tired they can't even think the right thing. You say mentally fatigued that they don't know what to do. What they can't even distinguish what is right, what is wrong. This is the amount of sadness or mental fatigue they get into. The next is chronic physical fatigue. Obviously, when you're mentally tired, you are physically tired. You will not be able to do anything for yourself, do anything for others. Now let us come to the statistics. This is the teacher burnout statistics that we have. And first year of working, 11.9% teachers face burnout. 2 years of teaching, 23%. 3 years, it goes to 28.4%. 4 years, 36.8, and 5 years is 41.3. That is almost 50%. There are teachers who've been 5 years into teaching, and this is a real statistic that 50% of the teachers in 5 years of their teaching life face burnout. So you see how bad the situation is, because when I come across people, they come and tell me teachers' life is very easy, but they don't understand that as a teacher, it's not just the students, it's the school, it's the academics, it's the parents. You're dealing with who are the one who makes the future of the students. So it's more worst for the teachers when I talk about burnout. I'm sorry, is somebody saying something? Okay, all right. So when I, the main intention behind me doing the seminar today was that we as teachers, we are the people facing the major burnout. If you take the case study of many people working in MNCs, working in normal jobs, teacher burnout is real. There are times when we don't even realize, but this is real. We have been facing this. This has been going on. If you look at the statistics, 50%. Imagine the number, 50% in 5 years of their schooling life, teaching life, they are facing this burnout. Also, I usually talk about burnout when I give the symptoms. There are people that say, okay, this symptom is there, this symptom is not there. So for us to better analyze, let us look at the questions, how to understand that, how do we see the signs of burnout. Just give me 1 minute. I have to stop share and please share just 1 minute. Let us see symptoms of burnout. Before we actually proceed to the question, let us see symptoms of burnout. How do you actually analyze yourself, or you analyze somebody close to you, close to others, or anybody? If there's anybody you can actually help them out, these are the symptoms. What these are the symptoms of burnout? Let us see. Especially teacher burnout. They're frustrated. They're not able to affect change. Many a times you will come across teachers, you will come across colleagues. They just want change to happen. There's a change in the timetable. Normal change in the timetable, they won't like it. Change in activities, school activities, they won't like it. They will lack fulfillment. It will be hard to find. They will not like teaching. And such teachers, there will be complaints of such teachers that they are good at the subject, suddenly they don't know how to teach, and suddenly they're getting verbally aggressive with the students. The amount of absenteeism in their class is increasing, or if you're in an IGCSE school, you see students opting out from that subject, people not attending her lectures. You have parents complain from such teacher. They're too overwhelmed. They feel that they're doing too much. They feel they're too overworked. And they just don't find satisfaction. They just don't find fulfillment. Then they're drained. If you see such, if you come across such teachers, they are emotionally drained, physically drained. Even if you try talking to them, they'll not talk to you. Just feeling tired, no matter what activity they are doing, no matter if their favorite subject is their favorite student, they just don't like doing the job. There's sleep troubles, which happens with most of the teachers. There's anxiety, there's inability to stop overthinking about them, because we as teachers are more vulnerable. Why? Because we don't have one student, we have many students, and their entire responsibility is on our head. If you're a subject teacher, less, but if you're a class teacher, the situation is worse for you, friends. Let me tell you this, you may not come across this situation, but it's better to be aware beforehand that there are sleep troubles, especially when there's exams and when there's paper checking. All this happens to us. Even we are not in that chronic stage, but this happens. And this sleep, when you come to teacher burnout, sleep troubles is the starting point for all of us. And reduce self-care, they neglect health. They don't advise students. They will go tell their students that you should do physical training, you should be exercising, but the teacher herself, no. She will start neglecting her health. The only thing that she will dress up and go, she'll just dress up and reach the school. Other than that, she's not taking care of her health. You will see either the teacher losing too much weight or the teacher gaining too much weight. And with teachers, it is opposite. The teachers start gaining weight. It's the opposite when it comes to teachers. Then lack of social desire. They don't talk to colleagues, and then they go out not only with colleagues, with the other friends also. They start becoming less social, and then they have a lot of complaints. These teachers will have complaints. They will have complaints against the school. They will have complaints against the colleagues. They will have complaints against the timetable. They will have complaints against the office staff. They will have complaints against the students. They will have complaints against the teachers. They will not be able to find themselves of silver lining. So teachers, this is a warning sign, and also principals, this is a warning sign. If you see something happening, know that they are on the verge of a breakout. They're already stressed, and there is a situation of burnout happening. You can help yourself or help your fellow teachers. We can do that. Next thing, before I begin, there are questions like, understand how stressed we are, stage of burnout we are at. I hope there's nobody who's reached the stage of burnout. There are certain questions which will help us analyze. First is, how often do you find yourself being irritable with friends, family, and others? How often? Is it very often, or it's like, okay, answer this for yourself. The activities, the main aim of my questionnaire is not to give me answers, not to give out answers. It is for your own well-being. Understand, analyze your own self, that how often, answer this question for yourself, how often do you find yourself being irritable with friends, families or with other people. When I say other people, you're traveling in the bus, you're traveling in the train, and you just end up fighting with people. That is how irritable you get, and how often you get irritable. Next question, friends. How often do you feel nervous and stressed? You are just stressed. You start feeling nervous that something bad is going to happen, something is going to happen. You started self-doubting yourself. How often do you do that? Next. How often do you feel you can't cope up with all the things you have to do? You think there's too much on your plate, there's too much to be done. I can't handle my school life, I can't handle my personal life, there's no work-life balance. I am not able to cope up with things. How often do you feel that way? Next. Do you ever have trouble sleeping? I'm sure major teachers are going to say yes. Yes, we all have trouble sleeping. So this is one problem that we have to take care of, teachers. Next. Do you ever feel like you are unable to control the important events in your life? You know that tomorrow is going to be a very important day for you. Tomorrow is going to be a very important event of your life, and you somehow feel you will not be able to cope up with it. You somehow feel like you won't be able to do it to the full of your potential. How often do you feel that way? Next. Do you ever feel sick without being unwell? You are not unwell. There's no disease, there's no ailment happening to you, no fever, nothing, but somehow you're feeling sick. You just don't want to go to work. How often do you feel that way? Do you tend to overreact to situations in your school, at your home, or with people outside? Do you tend to overreact and then you later realize, I shouldn't have done that? Do you do that? Next is, how often do you feel uninterested in the things going on around you? Suddenly, the things which may used to make you excited, the things which used to make you happy, suddenly there's you just don't like it. You're just uninterested. You just don't want to do things. How often do you feel that way? Next is, how often do you crave food? You miss meals. There's no end to your appetite, or you just don't feel hungry. How often do you feel that way? How often do you feel unable to make decisions? You're not able to make decisions. You're not able to come to conclusions. You are taking help of people. You're talking to people. Hello, am I audible? I think that's
audible.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Okay, ma'am. How often are you distracted before finishing a task? I was on the other point. How often are you unable to make decisions in spite of taking help from people, taking advice from friends, family, colleague? You're just not able to come to conclusion. You're not able to decide what you want. Then how often are you distracted before finishing a task? You know there's a deadline. No, that thing has to be done, but you're distracted. You just don't feel like doing it. Even if you're doing that task, just have your phone. You just randomly are scrolling through your phone, have nothing important on your phone. You are distracted because you just don't want to do the job. You just want to finish the task. Next is, how often have you been upset because of something unexpected? We know there are surprises. Life is a surprise, but surprise when it comes to you, you are just upset. You just don't feel nice about the surprise. You just don't want that unexpected thing to happen. You want to be in complete control. I want to do it this way, and it has to happen this way. You make no provisions for plan B, C, D. You just don't like it. How often does that happen to you? Next is, do you struggle to regulate how much caffeine, alcohol, or tobacco you use? Alcohol, tobacco, I'll say that will be a very extreme situation, but caffeine, how effect you are, or how easy it is for you to control your caffeine intake, not only caffeine, tea intake. Because we know we are Indians, we are fan of teas. So how often can you control? Even if you feel like controlling, you're not able to control. That urge doesn't go. Ask yourself this question. Next is, let's move to how to stop burnout. If you've answered major questions, yes. Even if you've not answered your major questions, your major answers were in no. Even if your sleep patterns, if you answered yes for sleep pattern, if you answered yes for your caffeine intake, your tea intake, and if you answered yes for just being irritated and you don't like changes, my friends, you are stressed. There is a stress problem. I'm not blaming you. I'm not a doctor to advise, but I'm saying that be aware. So it is always, we say that prevention is better than cure. So we know someday or the other, this stress is going to come, and stress comes in everyday life. So how do you stop stress becoming into a burnout? It's a breathing technique. It's called the box breathing. If you see on your screen, you can see a square. It's a box. It's a square. Yeah. Square, and it's a box. So if you breathe in here, do it with me. You breathe in, 2, 3, 4. You breathe in, you hold, you count until 2, 3, 4. Breathe out, then again you hold, and again you breathe in. Let's do this. Let's do this with me, teachers. At the count of 1, 2, 3, we'll begin. Breathe in. 1, 2, 3. Hold your breath. 1, 2, 3. Breathe out. 1, 2, 3. Hold. 1, 2, 3. This is by far the most effective way of controlling stress, of controlling your anxiety, of this something which your mind is wandering, you're not able to concentrate. This box breathing helps all of us. If you try this breathing, if you do this, it's going to help you. This is one of the major things that you can do to stop a burnout. Not only burnout, stop your stress levels, reduce your anxiety levels. You can do this box breathing. Next thing that we can do is take a walk. It is scientifically proven. I also learned it from somebody. I was told that your body is your shock absorber of your brain. If your brain is stressed, if there's something wrong, you're not able, your mind is not able to concentrate, your mind is not able to take it, to walk, your body will absorb the shock. I was actually taught this way ago when I was giving my final exams, that there are times when the paper is bad and next paper you just don't feel like giving because you are almost sure that you're going to fail the paper. That is the shock going on in your mind. Take a walk, your body will absorb that. Anytime when you feel that you're not able to keep up, you're too stressed out, take a walk. Your body is your shock absorber of the mind. Next is exercise. This, when I say, friends, it is very, very, very important. When I say exercise, it doesn't mean you give yourself a gym membership, join a yoga session. Good if you can do that. But exercise, when I say exercise, it is only moving your limbs, rotating your arms, rotating your feet, your knee, your joints, stretching yourself out. Also do the work. You have to take them out and exercise. The next is meditate. Find yourself some quiet time, some space, close your eyes and just breathe. Think about the good things. Automatically, you will see your stress level reduce. You will see yourself getting refreshed. It's just prioritize. Do first things first, then the last things last. Do not mix up. Do not do many things at a time. Prioritize yourself. Prioritize your task. Next is manage time. Very difficult to do, easier said than done, but you have to manage time. Because if you can't manage time, your stress will set in. And when the stress sets in, there is bound to be burnout. It's just always remember, you are a person first and a teacher second. Usually what happens with us teachers is we think we are teacher first and a person second. No, my friends, you are a person first. Till the time you are not healthy, you will not be able to bring out the good in your students. You will not be able to help your students. So you are a person first, take care of yourself first, and then you are a teacher second. Next is when we come across this prioritizing and managing time, let us move to the next session of our seminar, which is time management. See what we can learn. Before this, let's watch a video. 1 second, friends. I'll just play the video. I'll just watch one video. Is the screen visible, friends? Okay, let us see the video now. Let's move back to the slideshow. Okay, that we've watched the video, could somebody please unmute and say what did we just see in the video? There's one negative aspect and one positive aspect. Am I audible now? Somebody said that I'm on mute and you're not able to hear. Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, you're
okay. Yes, audible.
Okay. Now, talking about the video that we just saw, there is one negative aspect. There is one positive aspect. Somebody please unmute and say what is it they saw? Anybody?
Okay, can I?
Yes, sure, ma'am.
Yeah. Ma'am, I think it's a reflection of our life.
Okay, and how could you please elaborate?
Yeah, sure. Well, I think it's just a reflection in the manner that the stones, the bigger ones, these are the things which we are most stressed out about. And we feel that we are becoming heavy and we don't have anything to just let into our lives anymore.
Okay.
But the small stones, that is my perception actually, but the small stones are the blessings, or let's say,
yes,
ma'am. Maybe I'm wrong.
No, ma'am.
Blessings, yes. We sometimes ignore.
Correct.
If we sometimes ignore, something like this, that's what I think.
Okay, very good. Even I didn't have this thought. Very good, Farah ma'am. Very good. Anybody else? Anybody came up with some other thought? What did you see when you saw that jar fill or the jar empty?
Ma'am, can I?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, hi. This is Dr. Jaya. What I think is there are different kinds of things, or concerns, or issues that on a daily basis. You see that there were pieces of different sizes, from big rock to small stones and then finally sand. So
okay.
It's like, whatever is the most important person to need time, like, time for that. And when you start doing it on the basis of priority, there is still time left for things which are less urgent or less important. But what matters is that whatever is a priority should not be left out or missed out. Time management becomes easier when you know what is urgent and important, what is not urgent but important, important but not urgent, and what is simply can be avoided, which is neither important nor urgent. So there is enough of space in the jar, if it's a time jar of your life. It's all about how you prioritize. This is what I think.
Excellent thought, Jaya ma'am. This is what main intention of the video was. Farah ma'am, even you're not wrong, you can have your on perception, your mind can go in whatever creativity you can. But what more I wanted to say was that jar was your time. What we as individuals do, we first put in the bigger task. We only think we only have time for the bigger work. If you actually see a minute task, then there were little pebbles put in, there was sand, after the sand was put in, what you thought, okay, now it's done, I don't have any more time. What happens is, when you started pouring water, you saw that was so much time. So it's all about how well you can manage time, because 24 hours a day is more than enough. We always feel, I don't have the time, mere paas time nahi hai, I can't do it, I'm not free. What we do is because of a lack of time management skill. So if you look at the video carefully also, there are half day can fit in a lot of stuff. Why did that we manage it? Let's move ahead to the next part. Let's go through these questionnaire attendees. I would like you all to answer this for yourself. It will be a better judge for your personality. If you answer, then you will be able to better analyze what kind of a person or what kind of a time manager you are. Please answer this for yourself. It will help you. First question is, when working or studying, do you focus on completing tasks in a logical manner, step by step, or you just tend to flit between tasks? What do you do? Answer this for yourself. Remember your questions. Remember your answers. You'll have the answers in the end. Remember whatever answers you give. So, working or studying, do you focus on completing? You take logical steps 1, 2, 3, 4. You just flit between the tasks and you get it done. The second question. When you have work to do, do you like to get started on things quickly? You just want to complete it, just take the task and do it. Or often procrastinate, you don't want to do it. I'll do it tomorrow. I have a lot of time, I'll do it later. What do you do? The third question. Starting a project or assignment, do you plan for short-term and long-term goals? What is required now, later? What do you want to do? Where do you want to reach? Early plan in advance. You just find the deadline, the work and just fit into the slot. You just start work just before the deadline. What do you do? If you've answered the three questions, going ahead. Working on a project or an assignment, do you structure your time and you like to stick to the structure? You have a proper timetable, you get to fit into time, then you follow it dedicatedly, religiously you follow it, or handle surprises and last minute changes easily and enjoy them. You are okay with everything that comes to your plate, everything that comes to you. You just take it with an open mind. You're able to tweak in, you're very adaptive. Kind of you like working on your assignments. How do you like it? Next is, does your desk or work usually look like? It is tidy, it is organized, everything is put away, your filing is perfect, everything is kept in place, or it's untidy with piles of papers which look random. You can find anything. You can find a hair pin there, you can find your cup of tea lying there, you can find random rubber bands just lying. What does your desktop look like? If you've answered this, go ahead. Hope I'm not going too fast. Is the speed okay, attendees? Okay, going ahead. Working through a project or assignment, do you work steadily and consistently on it? You just concentrate on that and you finish it. Do you move into a higher gear as the deadline approaches? Earlier, you don't do the work, but later, you know when the fire is burning, you're on fire. You do it when the deadline approaches. Next, when planning a project or assignment, do you break down the task? You do step by step. There are ways you get things done. You prioritize, like this first, this comes second, this comes third. You use a to-do list, but frequently you rewrite. You keep ignoring. You write it down, you ignore. You again write it down, and then again you ignore. Then, attempting individual tasks. Individually, when you have to do the work, you generally follow through consistently. You keep doing it. You are self-motivated. This is what it is. And you start tasks, but in middle, you are just your attention goes away. You are not. You just want to do it. You leave it half done, and you hop on to another task. What do you do? Having answered this, working, do you prefer to work within rules and structures? You are a person who likes to be disciplined, or you who likes to follow the rules and regulations, or you feel confined when there are rules. You just feel suffocated that you can't come under pressure. You people can't tell you what is to be done. Are you that kind of a person? Trying to complete a task, do you find you can manage the length of time you spend on a task according to your plan? You can you can plan accordingly, you can have a timetable set and work according to a timetable, you can work long hours or find tasks often far longer than your estimated, and in the middle you start feeling bahut lamba hai, kab khatam hoga, when will it end, you have that attitude. Next, moving ahead, you're working on a project, you like set and reach goals, you have your preset goals, you like reaching your goals. You change goals as you go along. Today you think that okay, I want to do this. Tomorrow when you wake up, you have a completely different set of goals, a completely different mindset, or you do it for 2-3 days and then later you just don't want to do it. You switch your goal. Starting a project or assignment, do you like to make firm decisions about the project? This is to be done, this is not to be done, this is to be followed, this is not to be followed. This is making firm decisions, like you don't think. You take it as the day comes. You go with the workflow. You don't decide things. You like going with the workflow. We'll see what tomorrow brings. That is your attitude. Then, working through tasks. Do you dislike surprises and intervention? You hate people giving you end minute changes. You just don't like interruptions. You don't like anybody coming in between your time schedule. You don't like anybody interfering in your work. You need surprises. You're a person who likes variety, who likes new challenges coming in every day, new interests, some last minute changes to be done, something, some excitement in your work. Are you that kind of a person? Then, working on project or assignment, do you often complete projects step by step and well advanced in deadline, so that there are people who say, no, I'm saving time for a rainy day, what if I'm sick some other day, if I have to take a leave, then do task beforehand. So you act spontaneously, and sometimes appear you have no plan of action. You are a kind of a person, if I come to ask you next, you will not know what next. You know the work is to be done. How it is to be done, you don't know. You only know you have to complete the task which you will do. This is the only plan of action you have, no other plan of action. Once, when you've completed the project or a task, how often do you feel you are satisfied, achieved your goals, you're feeling very happy, you're feeling on top of the world that the task is completed well in time, or relieved it's finished, but you are regretful always. I could have done it earlier, I could have scored much better marks, I could have done it, next time I won't do it, next time I'll start early, I'll be on time. Having answered this question, let us see what personality do we fall into, a personality A type or a personality B type. If most of your answers were the first answers, the first option were your answer, your time management skill or your personality in time management is mostly judging. As a judging type, you prefer life to be planned and orderly. You like things to be done in an organized manner. You usually have step-to-step approach. You find it easier when it is planned and it is given to you in black and white. You find the task easier to be done. You find the ability to understand tasks better. You are able to, just don't like doing the whole bunch. You like to break it into chunks, and you always avoid last-minute stress. You don't like rushing at the end moment. You know beforehand where you're heading to, you respond well to your goals, you have guidelines, and you're very uncomfortable when it comes to some surprises, some interference, and you resist decision making. You don't like revisiting decisions, you don't like last minute changes. You actually, if your most answers were the first option, you're a good time manager. Your time management skill are excellent. You are very, you do things in an orderly manner. You have a very tidy workspace. You like creating a schedule which work with your time preference. You plan very much in advance, and you usually meet deadlines. You have, as a person also, you have very clear parameters in your house also. Things are done on time. Nothing goes haphazard. And also you're driven by support. You need such people. They usually so controlling in nature, they don't like being flexible. This is one negative trait you can say. They don't admire last minute changes. They are not too adaptable. They usually like to judge people who procrastinate, and they also struggle. These people who fall in the A category, they struggle to draw a line between work and family time. When it's work, it's just work. They want to get it done, and later they want to do things. This is how these kind of people are. However, second, if you answered mostly the second option, mostly B, then you're more of a perceiving time manager. Personality falls into the more perceiving time manager. You are flexible. You like spontaneity. You are uncomfortable when rules are put to you. When things are given to you in black and white, you just can't understand. You feel restricted. You think your creativity is put into parameters. You don't like following strict guidelines. You think your freedom is gone. Then to approach task in an oblique manner. You are not somebody with a very dedicated personality. You're better at starting things, but when it comes to finishing deadlines in the middle, what have a bumpy ride. You speed at the top, you do it very excitedly. You go down, you don't do it at all, and then at the end, you are on pressure and you finish it. Line on your head. This is your personality of doing things and managing time. Then usually when people see you, when people look at you, they usually judge you for being they judge you for being messy, they judge you for being disorganized, they don't like the sight of you, they don't like you, they always say you are in a mess, your table in a mess, you don't do things properly, they misunderstand you. And also you have a problem of time management. There are people who answered in B. We'll see, people who come with me, I fall in the B category, that we need help with time management. We need to break us down. There are certain things we should take it as given to us as rules and regulations, because with the adjusting personality that these people have, they can really do well. They can really finish task well before time, and they can even do another task, and they can do well beyond their potential. This is what perceiving personalities are. So the only negative trait is procrastination, which we need to help us with. Okay, moving ahead for the next section of the session. Where does my time go? Now let us answer this question. Many a times there are people who come telling me, whenever I talk about time management, first of all, people come telling me, you are talking about time management, a person like me, because I am in the personality B category. They always find me disorganized. They always find me not doing things on time. And then they're surprised how the work is done. But there are people who come asking me, ke 24 hours is too less. There are students also who come telling me, ke, ma'am, 8 hours of sleep need. And then all random things they keep telling me, where's the time? Let us now analyze. Utkarsh, could you please share the PDF that I shared with you, the worksheet?
Sure, ma'am. Is it visible?
Yes, it is visible. Okay, friends, could you zoom in a little, please? Little bit? Just a little. If it's not happening, then it's fine. Yeah, that's it. A little less. Okay, fine. Okay, friends, as you can see on the screen, I would like you to, if you have your phones around, you can do the calculation faster. Where does your time go? Now let us analyze where our time goes. First is, we have 7 days in a week. That is why that multiply by 7 sign is given there. Average number of hours sleep each night. Write the answers for you, friends. It is to help you all. The answers for you, average number of sleeps each night. If you sleep 5 hours a day, 5 into 7 makes 35 hours a week you spend in sleeping. For example, if you've done that, second, average number of hours spent grooming. When I say grooming, taking a bath, brushing your teeth, getting ready for work, combing your hair, everything comes into that. How much time does it take you to decide your clothes, to decide what shoes, which perfume, wash my hair, not wash my hair, especially for the females. How much time do you spend average on a day for self grooming, and multiply that by 7. How much hours do you take in the washroom? There are people like who takes 10 minutes in the washroom, then there are people who take an hour to have a bath. So what personality are you? Multiply that by 7 and you'll have your weekly answer. Next is average number of hours for meals or snacks each day. People who cook their own food, you will only put in your time of eating. The females who cook food, who have to do their responsibility in the kitchen, add the number of hours that you spend each day cooking, preparing food, preparing meals for yourself, for your family. Put it there, multiply by 7, you will have your weekly answer. Next is travel time. It is, you say, to from campus, or it is from work, school to work. Now since you're doing work from home, it doesn't count, but on an average, where much time does it take on an average for you to reach school and come back from school? Multiply by 7, you'll have your answer. Next, average number of hours you watch TV or play video games per day. Video games, when I do it with students, so I've put it here, but for teachers, how much number of hours you watch TV or you're watching Netflix, Amazon, Hotstar, Prime, and God knows whatever apps have come, whatever OTT subscriptions have come. How much time a day do you spend multiplied by 7, you will have your weekly time. Next, average number of hours on the computer for activities not related to your coursework. So if you're a teacher, you're not checking papers, you're not checking lectures, you're not even checking papers. What you're doing is just random scrolling, random, which will not help you anyway. You're only doing it, you don't know why you're doing it, but you do it. How much time do you spend doing that? If I say computer, it is your phone also these days. Phone also, all random scrolling that you keep doing. Scrolling to Instagram, scrolling to Facebook. And scrolling to YouTube these days, especially the females, want to try new recipes, one recipe after the other, one recipe after the other, and don't know where the time is gone. How much time do you spend doing that? Multiply by 7. Next, my favorite, average number of hours on the phone. How much time do you spend talking? If not talking these days, texting, other activity. This is all gossip, gossip queens and the gossip kings. If not, then how much time do you actually on the phone? How much time do you take? Multiply by 7, you will have your weekly answer. Next, average number of hours per week for regular activities like athletics, social work, social service, religious service, your spiritual activity. How much time? You can even, there are people who do it once a week, so just put 1 hour or 2 hours a week, just put the random figure. There are people who do it every day, multiply by 7 and put in your figure. Next, number of hours in class per week. How much time on an average? When I say hours, your Zoom, your Google Meet, your Microsoft Meet, whatever the teachers have been using, how much hours a day, how much hours a week, if you precisely know, how much hours a day you're spending teaching. Next, average number of hours utilizing university resources like you're using the learning center or you're tutoring or out of school, out of your work, you're doing something relating to your profession which is helping you grow. Put in that number of hours over there. Next, average number of hours reading, studying and completing assignment outside of class per week. Students, it is their homework. For teachers, it is the extra work that they get from school. Your roster update, your attendance, your checking, your student grades, whatever what you get from school. Average number of hours spending that reading for your class also, all of that. Next, average number of hours per week relaxing, exercising or taking time for yourself. You are just doing nothing. You are nothing at all. Oh, no screen time also. You're just relaxing. You're at peace. How much time do you do it? Yes, you do it for yourself. How much hours a week? Next, average number of hours per week with friends and family. How much time do you actually, I say time you give to your family, it is not just sitting on the sofa with your family around you. It is actual family time of talking to the people around you, talking to your actual family time, actual friendship. And just not that you are, I have students who go out for dinner. They don't talk to each other. I only see Instagram posts coming in of the food that they are all on their phone and not interacting with each other. Not that time, actual family time and friend time. The next is average number of hours per week of errands. When I say errands, it's your going to the bank, going to the doctor, getting your vehicle repaired, getting your cycle repaired, going shopping for yourself, buying vegetables for the females. I will put this for you, buying vegetables, buying the groceries, getting your monthly staples, all of that. How many hours? So you have all your answers. If you take a total, that the total is going beyond 168, my friends, you are not managing time because there are only 168 hours a week. Your total, and I'm sure when I did this activity first for myself, my total went way beyond 168 hours in a week. You only have 168 hours a week. Now that you've seen, you have your totals right in front of you, average totals, you know where you have to cut down. You know which are less vital activity. You now you are in a better position of knowing what to do and what not to do. Right. Utkarsh, can you stop sharing screen? Yeah, I'll share my screen now. Okay, so now we all know where does our time actually go. I think we have a better outlook of where the time is actually going. Moving ahead, how to manage time. Now, there are certain things that I can help you with that how best we can manage time. First is stop multitasking. It is always that multitasking is good, and especially the females pride themselves saying that we can do 10 tasks at a time. Do not do it. Do not multitask. Place your focus on one task. More focus you place on one task, the faster you will be able to do the job. Do not do 10 things at a time. Do not pride yourself, especially women teachers over here, especially me. I keep telling the male counterpart, I can multitask. I can do 10 things at a time. Do not do that. Stop multitasking. The minute you stop multitasking, you concentrate on single task, you will be able to do it better. The next is, use a Pomodoro technique. This is a Pomodoro technique. It is actually given to students, but we as teachers can also do it. You set a timer. You all have timers or stopwatch in our phones these days. You take your phone, put a stopwatch there, put a 25-minute timer, and you will only do one task. If you're checking papers, you will only check. If you're setting, you will set. If you're doing whatever important task you're doing, you will put that 25-minute timer. The minute something else pops in your head, the minute you think of something, just stop the timer, take a 5-minute break, back to the task. This, if you start doing this technique, you will be able to better concentrate. Your concentration levels can go up to an hour and a half without distractions. This comes with practice. You start with 25 minutes, you will come to know how much times, because what happens is we don't realize. We say, okay, main kaam kar rahi hu, wo kaam ke beech mein bahut sara kaam kar rahi hu, which we don't realize. Only see that, okay, this was a task, it took so much of your time, but we don't realize. Did our mind wander? In those tasks, you may not even scroll through Instagram. There is somewhere your brain is gone for a walk in the garden. You're physically doing something but not concentrating. That is when you're not producing any output. The minute that happens, stop in the clockwork. The very first time you do this activity, you yourself will realize that how much your mind wanders, how low is our concentration. If you do this, if you realize, if you have a control on your mind wandering, I'm telling you friends, 1.5 or 2 hours, you can go without a break concentrating on a task and increasing your output. Next is apply the 80-20 rule. It's known as the Pareto principle. It says, you know, usually the companies follow this attitude that 20% of their products give them the 80% revenue. Only 20%, they make 1,000 products, but only 20% of their products give them the 80% revenue. Similarly, our day-to-day life, we have 20% jobs which take 80% of our time. So it's important for us to understand which 20% of these tasks are taking up 80% of your time. You have to have this, that is it your actual task, is your actual important work. All random nonsense work that we keep doing is taking 80% of your time. Also, 80% of your life will take 80% of your life. 20%, 80% life. That you may have 1,000 friends. Only 20% of them actually matter to you. You matter to them. You talk to them on a daily basis. They affect you. You affect them. Find those 20%. Those are the only people whom you are supposed to give 80% of your time. Because what happens is we keep talking to everybody. One after the other, we keep attending our friends. We are talking to them, chatting to them. It's taking up our time. Find those 20% people. Require your 80% time. The others do not require. Do not require your time. Apply this rule. Your time management skills will be in a better position. Next is do the worst task first. The work that you hate, procrastinate, you want to do it, do that task first. It was said by Mark Twain. He said that if you eat a live frog first thing in the morning, live frog. Frog, we all know we are not Chinese people, we are Indians, we can't eat frog. If you eat a live frog in the morning, what's the feeling? The same feeling, do your worst task first. The minute you do it, you will have time for your most important task. You will not procrastinate. Why? Because that will build up. You will have to give up time from your important task and do the worst task. So what you do is, whatever you find it worst, do it first. You will see yourself relax. You will see your productivity double. Do your worst task first in the morning. The task that you know you hate, you procrastinate, do it first in the morning. The next is, take up early. Since it's become work from home, teachers who have school are waking up early. But then there are times we wake up early. Even 20 minutes waking up early will give you a head start. There is, if you wake up early, you will find that you will have a lot of time during the day. A lot of task is completed in the first half of the day, much before 11, 12 o'clock, half of your task is done. You will have more free time for yourself. Just 20 minutes will make the difference. Next is prioritize your to-do list. If you have to make a to-do list when you are making time, because even if you're not fond of making, just do this matrix, make the priority matrix. Here, you take how important the task is. Here, teachers, eco teachers, y-axis, this left hand side, the standing line, how important the task is, and this is the horizontal line, the x-axis, how urgent the task is. Priorities, important and urgent. If it is highly urgent, the first part of the matrix, if it is highly urgent and highly important, you do that first. Everybody will be able to classify, if you give it a thought, if you do it, you will be able to classify your high urgent task, the most important, high important and high urgent, you do them first. Next tasks which are important, not very urgent, but you know they're important, do it next. Why? Because if you procrastinate this now, later you will not be able to do this. So the next task that you do which are important, not very urgent. The third that you do is urgent, but they're not very important. So even though they're urgent, if you don't do it, it's not going to affect you. It will not affect others. That is how, when I say importance, it's not going to matter. If it is urgent and little important, you do it, but you do it after the first two. Then if it is not important and not urgent, do not do it. There are many tasks which we know are not urgent, not at all important, but we waste our time doing those tasks thinking that, okay, we need to put a time in here. Do not do that. If you put yourself in this matrix, because I am a teacher, I have to follow timetables, but there are many times when it comes to my own self, I don't have a timetable. I write it down, I don't do it. I'm the type B personality, like I told you. The minute I started doing this priority matrix, it helps a lot. I can bet on this, I can bet my life on this, that it helps a lot. If you can classify your tasks as urgent and important, you do it first, you will have a lot of time. Even the task that I put in this B matrix, that no action, don't do, well, even if you follow the first three, you will even have time for all these random and important things also you will get if you follow the priority matrix. Next, follow the 4 D's. 4 D's, when I say, only do the work which is your important task. The rest, you know, which does not require attention, delegate. Delegate it to your fellow colleagues, delegate it to your teacher. Sometimes come across people who are scared, who are insecure in delegating. Do not do that. If you don't delegate, eating up your own time, you will not have time for yourself, not have time for other activities. So do the important tasks which are to be done by you on your own self. Delegate the unimportant task or little important task, let the other colleague grow. Third is defer. For which task you will defer, which are not very urgent, not very important. Now, even if they are urgent, not important, you defer those tasks. This task you can do at a later stage. And no, it is not going to help you in any manner, not help you grow, adding nothing to your life, adding nothing, it's a futile exercise. Complete that task. You follow the 4 D's, you put the priority matrix. We all will be in a very good position to manage our day-to-day lives. And believe me, you will suddenly, magically, you will see, how do I have so much time? You will talk to yourself and say, how? I had this time, but earlier I didn't have the time. So if you follow these little steps, you will have a lot of time. A lot of time. You will also wonder that where was my time going. If you do this, you will be able to help yourself in life. It's the end of my seminar, friends.